Hey everybody, Ed Bowder from the Med School Medic Podcast, MedSchoolMedic.com, here with the first part of a four-part series on your EMT assessment. So now, when you start your EMT assessment, you're going to want to start with the first six steps, and I'm taking this from the National Registry assessment sheets. Your first part is going to be taking BSI or PPE precautions. Second part will be ensuring scene safety. Your third part will be determining the mechanism of injury or the nature of illness that's occurring with the patient. Your fourth part will be the number of patients, and then determining the need or the want for additional resources, and then checking C-spine precautions on your patient. So when you approach the scene, you want to take good PPE, it's personal protective equipment, or BSI, body substance isolation precautions. Now, the important thing to remember in this part is that it is not just gloves. One of the biggest downfalls we tend to have in our assessments, especially in testing scenarios, is we tend to say, I'm going to put gloves on, I'm going to move in. It is not just gloves. This also pertains to gowns, masks that you might have for any sort of airborne particulate, and also heavy equipment gear. If you're in an extrication type of scenario, you're going to want to wear a heavy jacket. You may want to make sure you have the right boots on. This kind of crosses over the full spectrum of things. It is not just gloves. So you want to make sure you have the proper personal protective equipment whenever you're approaching any patient assessment scenario. Your second is going to be scene safety. Right now, as I'm filming this, it is pouring outside, so you want to make sure that the road is clear and that you and your partner will not slip or injure yourselves. This also pertains to ice on the road. You want to make sure the structure that you're standing in is safe. Any potential scene dangers. One of the kind of fancy things we throw out is whether or not there's any weaponry involved. If you have a patient who's agitated, you want to make sure you have a police department on scene or someone to protect you and your crew. And always keep in mind that your first priority on scene will be you and your partners. We then move on to establishing the mechanism of injury or the nature of illness. So you want to figure out what's wrong with the patient and why you're there. Now, a mechanism of injury may be a motor vehicle crash, it may be a fall from a height. The nature of illness might be what's actually wrong with the patient. So someone who's experiencing chest pain, difficulty breathing, those will be your nature of illnesses. Once you move on past that, you want to determine your number of patients. Now, this specifically applies to a mass casualty incident. If you have 40 patients, you need to know if you have 40 patients. And if you have that many patients, you're going to need the proper amount of resources to actually assess and treat those patients. If it's just you and your partner and an ambulance, you don't have enough for probably more than one or two patients. So you want to know how many patients you actually have and how many resources you have at your disposal. And if you don't have enough resources, this is where you're going to call in for more resources. Now again, resources might not just be ambulances. It might be paramedics, it might be a fire department, it might be more police, it might be a rotor wing aircraft for a trauma scene, and it also pertains to the hospitals that you have around you. So if you only have a community hospital that doesn't have, say, a cath lab or a trauma center, you want to know which hospitals you have around you. And determining the number of patients might not be as easy as you may think. Generally speaking, we walk into a scene, we see one patient, that's our patient. But from time to time, you have to consider that you might have two different patients, and especially this applies to cardiac arrest, where you have the patient who's in cardiac arrest, and then you also have the family around you who may become patients as well. And once we do that, we have to determine or make the determination if the patient requires C-spine precautions. Now, generally in medical patients, there's not a whole lot of need for this. Usually patients who have a medical emergency aren't experiencing any type of cervical spine trauma. But in trauma patients, we want to ensure that there hasn't been any cervical spine damage. Now, this doesn't go into whether or not we need to put the patient on a backboard or put a C-collar on them. We just want to consider whether or not the patient actually requires C-spine immobilization. So, your first six steps, PPE or BSI, ensuring scene safety, determining your mechanism of injury or nature of illness, your number of patients, your additional resources, and then taking C-spine precautions. That's part one of your EMT assessment. My name is Ed Bowder from the MedSchoolMedic.com, the Med School Medic Podcast. You can find us on all the social media that's listed above, and also follow the podcast on iTunes or Apple Podcasts and Stitcher. We'll see you for part two.